Good morning, Vineyard families. It's good to be with you today. In today's lesson, we're going to see how through Jesus, God saves our sin because of his love for us. So why do you think that doing wrong things is a problem? Sure, we can get in trouble, but you know what sin does? It separates us from God and also from the good things that he wants for us. The Bible has a lot of names for Jesus, but in the book of John, 1st chapter, verse 29, which happens to be our memory verse for this week, it tells us of one of those names, which is the Lamb of God. Now, why do you think John called Jesus that? Well, in the Old Testament, under the law of Moses, to get forgiveness of your sins, you had to bring to the altar a unblemished lamb, a very clean lamb with no blemishes whatsoever. You had to bring that lamb to the altar for it to be sacrificed. And through the blood of that lamb, you were forgiven. That is why Jesus is called the Lamb of God, because he is God's perfect son. He's unblemished, he's perfect. And his death on the cross made the way for God to forgive our sins and for all of us who believe in him to have relationship with God. Today we're going to learn about how God rescued the Israelites from slavery in Egypt and how that act directly relates to how Jesus rescues us from the penalty of our sin. I am so glad that God made a way for us to be forgiven for the wrong things that we have done. Jesus solved that problem, the problem of how to have a relationship with God, even though we have done wrong things. Jesus is the Lamb of God.
Teacher Gigi, and this week it's gotten really hot again, and I'm so glad that we've been able to come out and use our pool some more. But you know, I was just thinking, when I'm out here by the pool, I want everyone to be so safe. And so, you know, I have a son who took lifeguard classes, and he has learned to save people from the water. But, you know, there's different things we can use. You know, some of us, we just have these kind of a floaty, and this is helpful if somebody's out there in the water. And then, you know, maybe you've seen something that looks like this. This is pretty common. This is a lifesaver on like boats. They always have these on board in case somebody is, you know, drowning. You throw it out to them. Or, you know, I know my babies, my grandbabies, they're little and they're just learning to swim. And these little life vests are considered to be lifesavers for them. And you know what? This is what you see with the lifeguards on the beach. They run down the beach and they save people from the waves. Yeah, this is a real lifesaver. But mostly, only all those things can save us from the water, but only Jesus can save us from our sins. That's what our story is going to be about today. So let's go inside. But in the meantime, I wanted to show you, this is my favorite kind of lifesaver. Well, out by the pool, we learned that only Jesus can save us from our sin because of his love for us. Our verse this week says, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." That's Jesus. But in today's story, we're going to hear about another man who in the Old Testament saved his people. Last week, you began to hear about the story of Moses. And that story is found in the Bible, in the Old Testament. It's the second book of the Bible, really close to the beginning. And the story I'm going to tell you today takes place over chapters 5 through chapters 12. So it's a lot of reading, but I encourage you someday to read it or have your parents read it to you and get all the details of what really happened. But today I'm going to tell you a shorter version of the story, where we'll pick up in the Pharaoh's palace. The Israelites had been slaves in Egypt under the Pharaoh for many years, and they were treated fairly severely. They had to build the palaces, and they were building the city for the Pharaoh, and it was very unfair how they were treated. So God sent Moses and prepared him and his brother Aaron to go before Pharaoh and tell him to let his people go. They just asked at first to go out to the desert to worship the Lord for 3 days. Now remember, Moses had grown up in the palace, so he knew how to behave before the Pharaoh. So the Pharaoh said, "Why should I let your people go? Who's this God they want to worship? I don't know him. No, go." He goes, "Get out of my presence. I'm not letting them go." And then he made life even harder for the Israelites. They had to make bricks, and for the bricks they used clay with straw to harden it and make bricks. But Pharaoh said, "No more straw for them, but I still want their same quota." So their work was like double. They had to get up hours earlier to go collect the straw just so that the brick would hold together. If not, they were going to be beaten. Oh, he was a miserable leader. And so God again spoke to Moses and said, "It's time for you to go and show him the signs and wonders that I've given to you to convince him to let my people go." So again, Moses and Aaron went before Pharaoh, and this time God told Aaron to throw your rod down and show him what I will do. So as Aaron threw down his rod, it became a snake. Well, Pharaoh looked at that. He goes, "Ah!" He goes, "Call my sorcerers, call in my magicians." So in came his magicians, and they likewise had their rods in their hands, and when they threw them down, all of their rods became snakes. And Pharaoh said, "Huh, well, you know, I just wanted to let you know this." When these were magicians, and magicians always use tricks, or what we call illusion. It makes you think that you see something that maybe you don't really see, or they use a trick to make stuff happen. They're not really using power. So Pharaoh knew he had some of these guys that could do stuff like that. So, but at that point, it's pretty exciting that the Bible tells us that the snake that Aaron threw down went and ate up all the other snakes. So God was still showing his power, and the magicians were all amazed. But Pharaoh only got angrier, and he said, "No, I will not let your people go." He said, "Go, get out of my sight." So Aaron and Moses left the palace that day, and they waited to see what God would tell them to do. Well, the very next morning, God told Moses to go meet Pharaoh down by the river where he takes his morning bath. And so Aaron and Moses went down there. And when they arrived at the river, God told them to stretch his rod over the river, Nile River. And as he did, the river turned into blood. And not only the river, but all of the lakes and even the water that they had gathered in pots and jars and jugs to use in their homes turned into blood. Oh, the people were miserable. They had nothing to drink. The Bible says that they had to dig around, like dig deep holes down to get some fresh water. And the river Nile, which was like their life to them, became blood and was useless to them for 7 whole days. But when Pharaoh was asked to let the people go again, he said, "No, I will not let them go." So Moses said, "Things are just going to get worse for you, Pharaoh." So the very next day, frogs appeared all over the land. Well, many of you might like to go frog catching. I know sometimes we do when we're down at a lake or something. But when you have hundreds of frogs all over you, and they're going in and out of your house, you can't keep them out, and they're in your bed, and when you start to make your food, that they're even in your mixing bowl, the Bible said they were in their bread dough, and they would eat it, and then they would go bite in a loaf of bread, and there would be a frog in the bread. Disgusting. It was so horrible. So Pharaoh called Moses and said, "Okay, what can you do to get rid of the frogs?" And Moses said, "Well, okay, I will get rid of the frogs." So Pharaoh said, "Okay, in one day I'll let you go." But as soon as the frogs were all dead, Pharaoh refused to let the people go. Oh, but the land stank because they piled up the frogs in heaps, and dead, stinky frogs. Oh, but he still would not allow the people to go. He refused to let them go. The Lord sent another plague. These plagues are things that are made difficult. It's like pestilence, things that made life very difficult. And so the very next plague that came was a plague of lice. Well, some Bibles say lice, some say gnats. Have you ever had gnats? Like when you're walking down, like where there's a lot of humidity, and you're having to swat them out of your face, and if you smile, you get them in your teeth. Well, these gnats were everywhere, except for where the Israelites lived. They had no gnats in their air, and they were happy, and it wasn't bothering them. So when Pharaoh saw this, he thought, "Well, okay, get rid of the gnats." But as soon as the gnats were gone, he did not let the people go. So God sent another plague, and this time it was a plague of flies. Oh, you know, I hate flies. I love to have like dinner out on our patio in the summer, and in the fall it's starting to get just nice at dinner time. But when these flies come around and they come and land on your food, well, at my house, you know, we have a dog, and our dog does his business over there on the rocks. And I know those flies go and they land right on that poop. And then they come over and they come in and try to land on my food. No. Flies are disgusting. It's gross. So these people were just covered with flies. But do you think Pharaoh would let the people go out of the land of Egypt? He would not. So God sent one more plague. And this time it was a plague on their cattle, and all the cattle became sick and died. The cattle and the camels and the sheep and the donkeys. And you know what? If they didn't have camels and donkeys, it's like they didn't have any cars, because that was their transportation. So this made it very difficult for them. And also, dead animals, they stink worse. They were as bad as the frogs. Heaps of dead animals. so disgusting. Ugh. But do you think God will let the people go? I mean, Pharaoh would let the people go? No, he would not. He refused to let the Israelites go. So the next plague that happened was a plague of boils. And boils are like sores. It's like if you get a mosquito bite and it gets swollen and full of pus. But even worse than that, it's like big pimples that are all over your body. And like you could squeeze them, and just squish out a cup full of pus. It's just disgusting. And the people were miserable. Everybody had them, but not the children of Israel. They were protected. But Pharaoh still refused to let the people of Israel go. So now God said the plagues were getting worse and worse. And this next plague was a plague of hail and fire. And it says this time when the hail came down, and if people weren't in their houses and the hail hit them, you know, sometimes we get hail here and it does a little damage, dents on the car, but people were being killed by these big rock size balls of hail. And with the hot the hail came fire, and it says it destroyed even a lot of the fields and a lot of their crops in the fields. But Pharaoh still hardened his heart more and would not let the people go. So one of the eighth plague now was a plague of locusts. Now grasshoppers are kind of, you know, cute to some people, and some cultures even eat grasshoppers, but when you have them so thick that it looks like a dark cloud coming in the sky, and the thing is everything that the hail didn't destroy, the locusts came and ate up, and they said, the Bible says there was not a green thing left in the whole land, that even it ate up the stuff that was in their pots, on their patios, their green potted plants, but all the rest of the vegetation, their wheat and their barley, was gone. So that made the people without food. Life was pretty horrible, but Pharaoh still hardened his heart. So the ninth plague that God sent was a plague of darkness. And this was a darkness unlike any darkness that we know. You know, most of you guys, even when it's dark out, you have a street light outside or a lamp post, and you get a little bit of light. Even some of you kids, maybe like the Kenans live way out, and maybe there's not so much light out there, but even still, in your house, you have electronics or digital radios or something that have a little light. You can probably, if you look really hard, you can still see your hand at night. But this darkness, they said, was day and night for 3 days, and they could see nothing. The people were going crazy because the darkness was so intense. And still, Pharaoh did not let his people go. Moses' people, the Israelites, go. So God said, all right, let's prepare. I'm going to send one last plague. Moses told the people what they needed to do to prepare for the last plague so that they would be spared. He said, take a lamb, a spotless lamb without blemish, and have it live with you 5 days. And on the fifth day, you are going to kill the little lamb. You're going to sacrifice it, prepare it for your supper. But save the blood of the lamb in a little bowl. And on that night, every one of the Israelites needed to be indoors and dressed and ready to go. And they needed to eat standing up. But they needed to take from the bowl of the blood and apply it to the doorposts and to the metal lintel. That way, their house would be spared from the death that was going to come, because the last plague was that every male son, every male animal in every household, the firstborn of each family would be killed. So, would die. And so the Israelites followed Moses' instructions. They went inside their homes, and they were spared. You know, this reminds me of when I see this, that I hope you can see it too, that the blood, when we apply it to our hearts, we put it across the doorposts of our hearts, and we can see the cross of Jesus. The blood of Jesus is what saves us from our sins, just as the people were saved by the blood of the Lamb. The Israelites were spared. We are saved by the blood of Jesus. That's the best life saver that there is. But the story ends that from then, the people were spared, but Pharaoh's house was not spared, and his son died, and Pharaoh was furious. So he called back Aaron and Moses to him again, and this time he said, "Go, take everybody with you. Take your women, your children, your livestock, and go and leave the land of Egypt." Well, we'll continue this story next week, but let's pray and thank God that He is our lifesaver, that He redeems us, that He rescues us. Lord, we thank you that you died on the cross for us, Lord, for our sins, that you shed your blood because of your great love for us. Lord, I pray that each child here would know of that great love, receive you as their Savior, and be able to live their lives to honor and glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, if you stay with us, I have a little song that we can sing to help us remember these plagues. Hi, this is my grandson Jack, and you're going to hear my husband Terry and his guitar in the background. We really think this is a fun way to remember the plagues and how God redeemed Israel from the Egyptians. I hope you like it too.
Then God sent plague number one. Turn the Nile into blood. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, let them go. Then God sent plague number two. Jumping frogs all over you. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, let them go. Then God sent plague number three, swarms of gnats from head to knee. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, let them go. Then God sent plague number four, filthy flies, need we say more. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, let them go. Then God sent plague number five, all the livestock up and died. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, let them go. Then God sent plague number six, boils and sores to make you sick. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, let them go. Then God sent plague number seven, hail and lightning down from heaven. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, let them go. Then God sent plague number eight, locusts came and they sure ate. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, let them go. Then God sent plague number nine, total darkness all the time. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, let them go. Then God sent plague number ten, Pharaoh's son died, so he gave in. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. Finally, Pharaoh let them go.
Hi everybody, I'm Chris and you know Malia. Malia wants to share the Bible verse this week. Are you ready, Malia?
I sure am, Chris. Okay, here it goes. Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. John 1:29. Chris, what does that mean?
Oh, that's a very important Bible verse. You see, Malia, Jesus was called the Lamb of God because he's God's perfect son, and his death on the cross made the way for God to forgive the sin of the people who believe in him. Wow, that's a very important Bible verse. He died for all of our sins, including yours and mine, and you too. Wow, we have an amazing God, don't we?
We sure do. I gotta go tell Charlie.
Okay, why don't we go tell Charlie, okay?
Okay. Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Hey guys, for our craft today, we're going to make a cross. And on it, we're going to put all kinds of images of goodies that remind us how awesome God is. Our Bible verse today is, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And that's in the book of John, chapter 1, verse 29. And our cross reminds us that Jesus became the Lamb of God. When in our story, Moses told the children of Israel to get ready by sacrificing a lamb that was perfect with no blemish, that the lamb was going to be sacrificed so that God could work his miracles. When God sent Jesus to die on the cross, Jesus was the Lamb of God, perfect to take away our sins. All right, so we have to begin with an 8.5 by 11 piece of paper. And so I'm gonna take my construction paper and make it an 8.5 by 11, boys and girls. And so I'm gonna measure this construction paper with my ruler, and I'm gonna draw down. And it doesn't have to be perfect, and I'm gonna draw a cross, and then I'm gonna cut it out. All right, you guys, go ahead and cut that out. And next, I need to make a pattern for my cross that will go on my construction paper for me to cut out the cross on my construction paper. And you can do it one of two ways. So you're either gonna go ahead and use a ruler to do it a little more precise, or you can just eyeball it. I'm gonna show you two ways, okay? So you can either take a ruler and take your 9.5 piece of just regular computer paper, or a piece of 9.5 by 11, just regular paper. We just don't wanna cut into our construction paper yet. And you're gonna draw a line to make a cross about 8 inches down. All right, and so you'll draw a line that's 8 inches down, and then, a line that's about 4 inches across. All right, and then you get your cross, and from there, I'm gonna go up from the top of where I start. I'm gonna go up about 1 inch, and I'm gonna make a dot, and I'm gonna come here from where I did my line about 1 inch, and I'm gonna make a dot. And I'm gonna come way down here about 1 inch, and I'm gonna make a dot. And over here about 1 inch, and I'm gonna make a dot. And then I'm gonna draw a great big line all the way around my smaller cross to make a bolder cross, okay? And so I find the middle dot, and I find about 2 inches, and I measure it. And about 2 inches, and if it doesn't come out just right, it doesn't matter. It's just so that you get an idea of how 2 inches came down here, about 2 inches, and so that you just have a good cross going, okay? So this is one way to do it with your ruler like that, 2 inches down here. All right, boys and girls, you'll figure that out. And then I'm gonna take that, and I'm gonna cut it out. So if it helps to draw with a large marker, go ahead and draw. That doesn't really even, I don't need to do that. So now I'm gonna cut this out around the edge like this. I'm gonna cut it like this, around the edge. It's even gonna make it look a little bit wider or thicker. All right, boys and girls, so you can do it that way. You continue to cut all the way around your cross. Okay, and this is even the easier way. I went ahead and drew just a line. I did use my ruler, and I stayed away from the top, and I came down about 8 inches. And then I just eyeballed it. I'm like, where would I like to have the top of my cross? And I made it about 4 inches like that. And then I just went ahead and I just started to go big all the way, like to, almost to the edges of my cross, and it came down like this. My hand wiggles. It's just something that happens, so I'll have to fix the wiggle. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. But you know what? God doesn't care if I'm not perfect. Great. Okay, so there's my pattern. My scissors isn't gonna wiggle as much, but when I go ahead and cut up this paper, it's gonna make a fine cross pattern for me to cut out on my, okay, you guys go ahead and finish cutting, and then we'll put the pattern on our construction paper. Now that I have a pattern, I'm gonna cut it out on my construction paper. And I'm just gonna come across and down, across. You get it? There's my wiggly hand again. But it'll all work out when I cut it. And it's gonna be covered up with some really pretty pictures as well. Nobody's gonna see that. And God doesn't care if I'm not perfect. There we go. And now I'm gonna cut out my cross. So this is the construction paper cross that I had started earlier. And I used this really fun magazine that came in the mail, and it had all kinds of colorful pictures in it. Ooh, there's, you can see my scraps that I had cut out. But what I came up with was pretty plants. And this came from, oh, a picture from, like, they had from Sesame Street in there. And I've got some flowers. And you can see I started to paste them on my cross. And pretty soon, I'm gonna cut off the edges. But you can see a little kitty cat, all right? So I'm gonna continue to take my glue stick and put my pictures. And so what I did was I glued the top part of the cross. And now I'm gonna glue the bottom part where I haven't gotten any, and I'm gonna go all the way down the edge like this and around, glue down the edge and color it in. So I've got glue all over it. And now I'm gonna finish putting my pretty pretties. Guys, you don't have to call them pretty pretties. You can pick out any manly pictures you want of, like, soccer balls. Anyway, I'm gonna go ahead and glue these on. You guys glue yours on. When I'm done gluing all of my pretty pictures on there, then I'm gonna turn it over and I'm gonna trim what I've got here. And so, just gonna kinda cut up like this. Yep, and cut off like that. So boys and girls, I want you to finish trimming your cross like that. You guys go ahead and continue to trim. All right, guys, so I have my cross finished and I really like it, but I want to write Lamb of God right over that. When I hang this on my wall, I want to look at it and remember that Jesus is the Lamb of God and that God forgives all of my sins and God's always there to help me. You ready? And my cross is done. And it says, Lamb of God. I hope you enjoyed making your cross, boys and girls. Have a great week.
Hey, so I'm just walking around my house thinking I should probably recite my Ten Commandments. Our story today was about Moses. And I should be able to recite them like they just flow off my tongue. Can you do it? Let's see. All right, so I'm just gonna walk around and so glad to be home and so thankful. All right, thankful for people in the Bible like Moses that actually he came around to listening to what God wanted him to do, right? So here we go. All right. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. And number two, thou shalt not make any graven images or idols and worship them. Number three, Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Number 4. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Good job, you guys. Right, Kaya? Woo-hoo! All right, number 5. Honor thy father and thy mother. What are you going to do for your father or your mother today? Number 6. Oh, there she goes. Thou shalt not kill. Number 7. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Number 8. Thou shalt not steal. And number 9 is thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor or anybody. And number 10, thou shalt not covet. Remember what covet is? Don't want to take something that doesn't belong to you. So there's our 10 commandments, and I memorized them. I said them off the cuff. I'm just so thankful that God gave us instruction. Start with those 10, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and we'll be doing pretty good. Bye, everybody. See you next week.
Passover is more than something that happened to the Israelites many, many years ago. It is also a picture of how God made a way for us to be saved by Jesus, the Lamb of God. Without God's forgiveness, we can't escape the penalty of our sin. It's as if we are in slavery, just like the Israelites were. But when Jesus died on the cross, he paid the price for all the wrong things that we have done. When we trust in Jesus, we are truly free and part of God's family forever.